Start with today's session. Welcome everybody. It's my pleasure to present to you today's future guest of ours, Moishe Postone. Moishe Postone is one of the leading contemporary Marxist intellectuals and representatives of the tradition of critical theory of society. He's perhaps most widely known for his magnum opus, Time, Labor and Social Domination, where he undertakes a fundamental reinterpretation of Marx's mature theory and provides a conceptual apparatus for grasping the historical dynamics of contemporary capitalism as well as of so-called actually existing socialisms of the 20th century. He's also a co-editor with Eric Sandler of The Catastrophe and Meaning, the Holocaust in the 20th century, which is basically a collection of essays that consider the meaning of Holocaust in the 20th century and its effects on social, political, and historical practice up to this day. On several occasions, he has also commented and written on the questions concerning the contemporary left, including present-day mass mobilizations, forms of anti-hegemony, anti-imperialist struggles, and so on and so forth. Moishe Postone is currently a professor of history at the University of Chicago, as well as a senior fellow at the Internationales Forschungszentrum Kulturwissenschaften in Vienna. Today's discussion will take the form of a public interview with me being the interviewer and, of course, Moishe being the interviewee. My idea was to divide this interview into roughly into two consecutive parts. In the first part, we will discuss central thesis of your time, labor, and social domination, so that those of you who are not familiar with his work can get acquainted with his theoretical background, and those of you who already are familiar with his work can get a better understanding of it. And in the second part of the interview, we will address some pressing present-day issues concerning the contemporary left. So let us begin with the first part of the interview. So, in Time, Labor and Social Domination, we developed a pretty impressive reinterpretation of Marxist mature theory, reconsidering fundamental categories of the critique of political economy against the background of what you call traditional Marxism. So, traditional Marxism grasped capitalism primarily in terms of class struggle, private property, and market-mediated distribution. So my first question would be, how does your conception of capitalism differ from that of traditional Marxism? How can your critical theory help us to grasp the contemporary phase of capitalism in your neoliberalism?
You characterize my notion of traditional Marxism in terms of class struggle, where capitalism is defined in terms of private property and market. And I argued that underneath that, theoretically, was the notion that labor not only creates all wealth in society, but is the standpoint of the critique of capitalism. And labor being the standpoint of the critique of capitalism implied that the overcoming of capitalism would be the realization of labor in the Hegelian sense. It would be that those who work would come into their own, and society would be governed in the interests of those who work. And looking at Marx very carefully, I came to the conclusion that that may have been true of Engels. As a matter of fact, it was true of Engels, and what we usually call Marxism really should be called Engelsism. that Marx has an extremely different point of view. And that point of view is, first and foremost, a critique of labor. Labor is not the standpoint of the critique of society, but rather is the object of the critique. Now, what this means, without going into all of the theoretical twists and turns, I argue that Marx's notion of overcoming capitalism was tied with an idea that he had that capitalism was going to undermine the basis of proletarian labor and at the same time remain based on proletarian labor. So it would empty labor out of its content and it would reduce the number of people who are working. This was his notion of the long-term development of capitalism. And that overcoming capitalism would mean overcoming proletarian labor, not realizing proletarian labor. So what I've tried to do with Marx is two things at once: provide a critique of traditional Marxism, but not in the name of liberalism, but rather in the name of another critical theory of capitalism.
Thank you. So you've stressed this crucial distinction between two different standpoints of critique. So first of that being the critique of capitalism from the standpoint of labor, a characteristic for traditional Marxism, and on the other hand, the critique of labor in capitalist society, characteristic for critical theory. So according to this schema, it is obvious that the traditional theorist takes the standpoint of the proletariat, the working class. But what is the epistemological position of the critical theorist? So what is the standpoint of the critique of labor?
The standpoint is not a social movement. Whether it's the proletariat or it's those who have been marginalized, whether within society or in terms of global society, the standpoint is temporal. I try to argue that the long-term development of capitalism involves a kind of a double motion, that on the one hand, you have the ongoing transformation of everything, and on the other hand, you have the reconstitution of the fundamental basis of capitalism, which is not private property and not the market, it's labor. So the necessity of labor is reconstituted even as it's been undermined. And most theorists about the dynamic of capitalism take one or the other dimension. Either they see ongoing change, all that is solid melts into air or acceleration, or they presuppose that capitalism always already is the same, and the only thing to worry about is how to get the proper consciousness to then recognize capitalism and overthrow it. And I wanted to suggest, and it's really at this point a suggestion, that it's the growing gap between what is and what could be, that this gap between a possible future and its constraint is what allows for critique. It's not on the shoulders of any social group.
Thank you. This critical theory, the project of critical theory, the way you see it, basically has a much broader conception about what Marx's theory is all about. especially in relation to traditional Marxism. This Marxist theory was usually conceived only as an economic theory, especially the theory of the mature Marx. But you see it basically as a theory which grasps forms of subjectivity as well as forms of objectivity which are characteristic for modernity as such. So my question would be, how would you argue against this reductive view which reduces Marxist theory to economics? And if, as you claim, Marxist theory is not simply economics, what is it then? Is it the work of sociology? Is it the work of philosophy? Or would you perhaps agree with Max Horkheimer, who maintained that critical theory is against or basically opposes such rigid separations between philosophy, science, and social theory, and so on?
The theory that focused only on exploitation really had a very bourgeois notion of subjectivity, which was that of interest. It may not have been individual interest, it was class interest. The content of the cultural forms was irrelevant. You have an objective economic structure of exploitation, and the question was, how could you organize to overthrow? The first, I think, after Marx, who saw that the categories were intended as something else, was Georg Lukács. There are many things I don't agree with in Lukács, but he certainly understood that when Marx uses the word commodity at the beginning of Capital, he is not referring simply to things that are moved around, but a whole way of thinking. And it's a whole way of thinking where the universe then becomes viewed in terms, on the one hand, of abstract, law-like phenomena that have no personal author, and on the other hand, by concrete materiality, and that this opposition runs like a red thread through modern Western thought. Some people taking the side of the abstract, other people taking the side of the concrete. But the main point is that he recognized that, for example, in the first chapter of Das Kapital, Marx tries to derive notions of equality, of human equality, from the commodity form. He then moves on to questions of freedom, and tries to show how these conceptions don't come out of the blue. They also aren't Western in any meaningful sense. They're modern and they're related to capitalism as a form of life, not as a form of exploitation. Does that help?
Yes, I think so. Okay. You also mentioned that you do not agree with everything which says so. Where do you see the shortcomings of Lukács's approach?
It should be clear. Incidentally, I agree very much with the comment with the Horkheimer. It's not an economics of philosophy and sociology. My approach to Marx is both a critique of Lukács and Horkheimer, and it's very indebted to them. So in a sense, I've learned a lot from them, and then I use their own approach, in a sense, against them. It seems to me that what Lukács did was, well, theoretically, he never got beyond the dichotomy that I talked about. And it has to do with his theory of use value, but that might be a little too detailed. Politically and socially, he reified the proletarian debt. And the only question was, how would the proletarian achieve consciousness in a world of reification? And so he, in a sense, held the proletarian constant. Instead of saying that in the book, Das Kapital, past the first chapter, what you get is the ongoing transformation of labor and of the proletariat. And instead he does a kind of a Hegelian dialectic of subject and object, and doesn't really get into categories like relative surplus value, real subsumption of labor, which have a subject, an important subjective dimension. I'm only touching the surface, but I simply don't know how much detail I should, you know, go into in a public interview.
Can you go? At least can you give people more details? I think they shouldn't mind.
Well, on a theoretical level, Lukács picks up very strongly on Marx's notion of the commodity. I don't know how you say commodity in Slovenian, but you have to say it, right? And for Lukács, well, for Marx, the commodity has two dimensions. A historically specific dimension, which he called value, and a material dimension, which he calls use value. And if you read Lukács carefully, he really then just takes the standpoint of use value, as if this is sort of like a quasi-natural substratum, and value is a kind of a veneer on top. And in a way, the revolution is sweeping away value and allowing use value, which includes labor, to come into its own. But the category of capital in Marx is a dialectic of value and use value, where value begins to mold use value. Use value doesn't stand outside of it. And the two interact with one another, also temporarily. And that dialectic, Lukács doesn't have. Neither do Adorno nor Kant.
On that level.
Yes, on that level.
Yes.
It takes the standpoint of use value, but what again then in this opposition between value and use value, where does the critical theoretician stand? How does he approach this double? No, critical theory as you see it, how would you approach this?
What I said before?
Yes, double dimension of the commodity, the use value and value, and where you see that. Emancipatory standpoint.
Okay, I'll say what I said before, but in slightly different terms. The dialectic of value and use value, once Marx introduces the category of relative surplus value, let me explain. Explain relative surplus value. Marx has two categories. One is absolute surplus value, which is, let's say workers are working 8 hours. And let's say the amount that they produce in 4 hours is enough to reproduce themselves. The other 4 hours belongs to the capitalist, it's surplus value. The easiest way of increasing surplus value is to increase the labor day. So instead of the workers working 8 hours, let them work 12 hours. Let them work 16 hours. 4 hours will still be enough to reproduce themselves. And the longer you extend the working day, what Marx called absolute surplus value, the more surplus value there will be. And in fact, historically, there is a huge huge increase in the amount of time people work, starting in the late Middle Ages and going through the beginning of the 19th century. A huge increase in labor time. And at least in Marx's account, the turning point is the struggle on the part of workers in England for the 10-hour day. And they win that struggle. And an interesting thing happens as a result, because class struggle isn't just class struggle. Because they won the 10-hour day, surplus value could no longer be generated, that is, an extra surplus value, by extending the day beyond, because you couldn't legally. I mean, of course, on the side, people always try, but that isn't how you do an analysis. So instead, the other way of increasing surplus value is if you can, on a socially general level, decrease the amount of time it takes for workers to reproduce themselves. So instead of it taking 4 hours, maybe it'll take 2 hours if you double productivity. So there becomes a built-in motor for increasing productivity. If you increase productivity, the amount of labor time required to reproduce the workers drops. However, let's say it's a 10-hour working day, and let's say the workers work 5 hours for themselves. If you double productivity, it takes only 2.5 hours for them to reproduce themselves, so you gain 2.5 hours. If you double productivity, you gain 1.25 hours. If you double productivity, you get half of that. In other words, you have a built-in dynamic that is like an asymptotic curve, and very few people have paid attention to this, where you have suddenly, within capitalism, a huge demand for increasing productivity on an ongoing way. This has nothing to do with the course of human history that always, from the time of the Neanderthals, people have tried to save time. That's just not true. It's just not true. The great French anthropologist, Claude Lévi-Strauss, pointed out that after what is frequently called the Neolithic Revolution, where in the space of a couple thousand years, people invented animal husbandry, agriculture, weaving, pottery, metallurgy. Things didn't change very much until the 16th century in Western Europe. Any notion of just an evolutionary development is actually a projection backwards of what become attitudes in capitalism is read backwards as being true of human history. So you get this built-in motive, really, for increasing productivity. Now, on the one hand, if this is across the board, what it means is increasing productivity means, among other things, increasing raw materials. You can only really increase output by increasing raw materials. It means increasing your use of energy. So on the one hand, what you have is the beginnings of a theory that could tie capitalism to what today we call, you know, the environmental crisis. On the other hand, increasing productivity means that there is a built-in payoff to try to decrease labor time and eventually mechanize it, or today mechanize it. And yet Marx argues that in this way, capital develops the basis for abolishing proletarian labor, and it will always, however, reconstitute it. So you get the beginning of a gap between labor organization that could be, and labor organization and social organization. That is, because fewer and fewer workers means more and more people become superfluous. Whether that superfluity is in terms of the precariat or the permanently unemployed or underemployed or the dispossessed in large parts of the world.
Not a trans-historical method.
So in a funny way, as opposed to when Marx was a young man, I suggested that what he is suggesting in this paragraph is that the rational core of Hegel's dialectic is that it's idealist. The subject is actually, he's left behind a Feuerbachian turning the heavens to earth, and now the subject is the proletariat or humanity. But rather, the idealism grasps the fact that this dialectic is socially created, but is abstract. So it doesn't appear to be social at all. It's an abstract movement. And Hegel's idealism is, in a sense, a foreshortened way of trying to get over that. So I think that his later critique of Hegel is quite different than his earlier critique.
Okay. Did I forget part of the question?
No.
I was joking.
Okay, so I just have one more question for the first part of the interview concerning some topics of your time labor and social domination. Probably one of the most intriguing topics is that of time. And you write a lot about the social constitution of time and introduce categories such as concrete time and abstract time and talk about how did this contemporary prevalent notion of time come into being and what was capitalism's role in it. So would you just briefly elaborate on your conception of time?
In 25 seconds or less.
5 minutes.
Instead of dealing with time as either linear or circular, what I suggested was that it might be more fruitful to think of time as either concrete or abstract. And what I meant by that, what I meant by concrete time, is that time is a dependent variable. It is dependent on other phenomena, most clearly something like the seasons or the day. Now, I was struck in doing my research many, many years ago that our notion that the day has 24 hours actually was developed first in ancient Egypt. And they divided the day into 12 daytime hours and 12 nighttime hours, which meant that in the summer, daytime hours were longer and nighttime hours were shorter. And in winter, daytime hours are shorter and nighttime hours are longer. In other words, the hour is a dependent variable. It varies with the seasons. Now, a lot of people think that our notion of the hour as being constant is because the clock was developed. I think it's the opposite. Because already in the ancient world, they developed very sophisticated timepieces that would vary the hours with the seasons. And the Japanese had this system, and when the Jesuits first introduced clocks to Japan in the 16th century, it's not that the Japanese said, oh, this is wonderful, and now we know that an hour has 60 minutes, regardless of whether it's winter or summer. Instead, the Japanese, for 400 years, built clocks that were so sophisticated that they varied the hours with the season. In Japan, they only changed this during the Meiji Restoration, that is when capitalism was introduced. I suggested that our notion of the hour as constant really has to do with the issue of the working day. And the working day slowly became separated from what it always had been. You begin work at sunrise and you end at sunset. The working day became defined in hours. And those hours were constant. And this happened over a 200 to 300 year historical period. So I suggested that abstract time first emerges historically out of certain practices, and that the idea of abstract time comes out of that. There's a social historical basis for abstract time. And then I develop a notion of historical time.
Okay, we don't have time to go into that.
We don't have time.
Yes. So I suggest we advance to the second part of the interview concerning the contemporary left. So I would first like to concentrate on some of the issues you cover in your essay, History and Helplessness, where you touch upon the questions of internationalism and mass mobilization of the left in the context of historical changes in the late 20th century. So you talk about this transition to neoliberalism, you talk about the collapse of pre-existing socialism and the end of the Cold War. So how do you think that this event affected the like mobilizing potential and other features of the contemporary left?
I wrote this essay in part as a reaction to the kinds of mobilization which were gigantic against the war in Iraq. And I was struck by the difference between those mobilizations against the war in Iraq and the mobilizations that occurred decades earlier against the war in Vietnam. I think there's a fundamental difference between them. And it says something about what happened to what is called anti-imperialism. The protests against the war in Vietnam were not only, but they certainly also were, a protest against a really systematic, destructive bombing of an entire population. I mean, so many more people were killed in Vietnam than I think we've experienced since. But it was also tied to the idea, whether correctly or not, is beside the point. It was tied to the idea that the Vietnamese were fighting for something progressive. And that if it weren't for the Americans, that you would get a much more progressive development in Vietnam. So that it wasn't simply a struggle against the Americans, it was the struggle for what was considered to be an emancipatory movement. That's absent in the huge demonstrations against the war in Iraq. They were gigantic. They were the biggest demonstrations for almost a half century. But they weren't in any way tied to any notion of progressive change. No one could imagine that Saddam Hussein represented progressive change, except for some, and there were some, weird anti-imperialists for whom the Ba'ath Party, whether in Syria or Iraq, supposedly represented something positive. So what happened was that basically, I think behind their own backs, portions of the left took over what had actually, between the wars, been a right-wing trope, which was pure anti-Americanism. That's not the same as a criticism of America. But somehow, where America suddenly represents what is evil in the world, and if you just got rid of that, things would be okay. Which is one of the reasons why you'll notice all of these huge demonstrations led to nothing. There weren't movements that came out of that, as opposed to the anti-Vietnam demonstrations that really were part of and then were generative of movements. So instead of a left trying to deal with a real dilemma, which is how do you deal with a case where an imperial power is attacking a local fascistoid power? How do you deal with that? Maybe one thing that you try to do is locate Iraqi oppositional. And they existed. And were hounded by Saddam after, you know, for sure. None of them were ever invited to any of the major rallies against the war in Iraq. What you didn't get, which you certainly got in the 1960s with regard to Vietnam, what you didn't get was a different perspective. A perspective that could be critical of America, but also tell people about what the nature of this bloody regime of Saddam Hussein was like. And so I wrote the essay against that background.
And I think that the discourse, this dubious anti-imperialist discourse that you criticize, can also be detected, at least it's somewhat similar in Europe, for example, where the main structural antagonisms in the European Union are considered in terms of, say, central power, that is Germany, economically and politically oppresses peripheral countries such as Slovenia and Greece, for example. So, how do you have any comments on the situation right here? Or, for example, you also wrote that in the Middle East, this structural place of an evil superpower is usually occupied by Israel in this discourse. So how would you comment on this anti-hegemonic discourse in Europe and Middle East?
I think they're different from one another, and I don't know enough about the European case. I do think, first of all, from the very beginning, it is a mistake to think of this in national terms. Germany is oppressing Slovenia. Germany is oppressing Greece. Well, the German banks for sure. But the German banks work hand in glove with the Greek oligarchs. And there are Greek oligarchs. After all, that's what that society really is. There never was a state in Greece, not since 1823. You have these fabulously rich people, remember Onassis? Fabulously rich, who are basically not taxed. And I may be a little unfair, and I really am unsure here, but it seemed to me that Syriza played the national card and didn't go after the oligarchs. I don't think you have a transformation of the tax structure within Greece. So I'm very suspicious. On the one hand, of course, people like Schäuble and, you know, the central bank of Germany, of course they should be opposed, but that's not Germany. That's German capital. And it's not oppressing Slovenia as a whole. Yeah, and I'm very suspicious of reifying movements in national terms. The Middle East is slightly different, and that has to do with the unfortunate long history of the ideological Cold War in the Middle East. I don't know what it's like here, but certainly in the United States, on college campuses, to the degree to which there is any movement about anything in the Middle East, it always is exclusively about Israel. Not that Israel, especially the regime of the last 10 years, shouldn't be very strongly criticized, but it's not the point. My point is, I haven't seen one movement about Syria. This is the greatest slaughter of people we've seen since the Second World War. Assad has killed at least 300,000-350,000 people. The list has nothing to say. Nothing, just as they said nothing about Saddam. At all. You would think that after the beginnings in Syria of a democratic uprising that was, with incredible brutality, put down by the Assad regime, you would think that that would ring a bell. So I think that large parts of the left have essentially lost their theoretical acumen, their political analysis, and their moral compass. Doesn't sound good.
One of your theoretical preoccupations has always also been the question of anti-Semitism, and I would like to pose some questions regarding the contemporary forms of anti-Semitism, but first I'd just like to ask you if you could explain your theory of anti-Semitism in general, because, for example, in your article National Socialism and Anti-Semitism, you use the categories of Marxist critical theory in order to explain the phenomenon of anti-Semitism. Could you just briefly elaborate how can this Marxist conceptual apparatus help us in understanding modern anti-Semitism?
Well, instead of giving the sort of Marxian explanation, I think what's very important is to begin to understand why anti-Semitism isn't another form of racism. It's its own thing. It's not better or worse than other racisms. It's different. And that difference is frequently not apprehended. I argue what characterizes modern anti-Semitism is not that Jews are inferior, but that they are globally powerful. That essentially, anti-Semitism developed as a way of understanding the world. The world in Europe was changing very rapidly. You have abstract forces changing, and you don't know why, you don't know what is going on. It's a little what's happening in the United States now, where you've had a strong decline of the industrial working class. They don't know why or how or what, so maybe it's the Mexicans, Donald Trump. But the Mexicans might be the cause in the United States, but no one in the United States, not even the most insane racists, think that the Mexicans rule the world. Anti-Semitism is different. Anti-Semitism is a way of explaining the entire world in terms of conspiracy. It's the inordinate power of a small group of people who manipulate the rest of the world. I don't think you can understand the Nazi attempt to exterminate the Jews if you don't understand that they regarded the Jews as being a tremendous danger? That form of anti-Semitism, after the war, reappeared in a place where one wouldn't necessarily have expected it. It reappeared in the show trials in Czechoslovakia in 1952. I don't know whether any of you know anything about the show trials. 14 members, all of them members of the Czechoslovak Communist Central Committee, including the Secretary General, were put on trial. I mean, of course, the orders came from Stalin. They were put on trial. Now, of those 14, 11 were Jews. These were people who had been lifelong communists. Many of them had fought in Spain. And they were accused of being members of a shadowy global conspiracy that was the enemy of mankind. And the negative, for ideological reasons, this is 7 years after the war. The prosecutors couldn't say Jewish, so they said Zionist. None of these guys had in any way been Zionists. What the Soviet Union did there was they fused Zionism and Judaism. And that fusion they carried after 1967 into the Middle East. Now, before 1952, communists, of course, had been opposed to Zionism. But they opposed Zionism as they opposed many nationalist movements as a bourgeois nationalist movement. That's very different from regarding Zionism as suddenly being this dark force that controls the world. It's really the fascist notion of the Jew, propagated by late Stalinist Soviet Union. It disappeared for a while, and then it emerged in 1967 after Israel defeated the two main Soviet client states, Egypt and Syria. And then Soviet propaganda began once again with this anti-Zionism. And that has spread, and it's completely muddied discussion of the Middle East. Because the critique of the policies of regimes like that of Netanyahu, of the settlements, etc., becomes fused with this other dimension of anti-Zionism. So it becomes very difficult to separate them out and have a proper political discussion about it. I think it's played an incredibly destructive role, but you can see it in all sorts. There was a book written by two American academics, Steve Walt and John Mersheimer, on how the Iraq War was because of Israel's influence on the White House. Because the Iraq War was against American interests. Now, maybe it was. But you would expect in a serious book that they would outline what American interests were. They never did. So suddenly Israel becomes the power behind the United States. The United States is sort of this poor, unwitting, innocent entity that's controlled by a global conspiracy. So you have to be very careful with the word Zionism because it has different valences. And they become really quite confused with one another, which has, you know, which then in reaction, there are many Jews who then regard any as being anti-Semitic, which it's not necessarily, but some are. So anti-Semitism is different than racism in the sense that racism, no matter how vicious and it is and can be very vicious, doesn't really accord the racial other that kind of power. Whereas anti-Semitism is characterized by the imputation of this kind of abstract shadowing power. It's like Orban is now always talking about the shadow power. You know, if one is attuned to this language, one knows what he's saying.
Now that the effects of the crisis in the Middle East can be seen in Europe, millions of refugees are fleeing from Syria, Iraq, and Afghanistan, and knocking on the doors of European countries. And I've also read that this is actually an Israeli-American conspiracy. Okay.
So was 9/11.
Yet the European countries are willing ever higher voice to stop them, and this refugee crisis has facilitated many openly reactionary, racist and xenophobic discourses in Europe. So how would you comment on the current situation in Europe regarding the refugee crisis?
I wish I had at least a small glimmer of optimism. I don't. I remember, and it was a little prescient, there was a conference in Berlin, maybe 2011, I forget, 2012, and you know, I was speaking, not my formal speech, but afterwards, and someone asked me about migrants, but it was less about migrants here at that time, and it was more about Mexican and Central American migrants to the United States. And I said that one of the real problems is that almost the entire discussion about migrants is, yes, we should be open, or no, we should keep them out. But there's very little discussion about what's causing the migration. What's behind the migration? Is there anything that one can do that will change things positively for these very large number of people who are fleeing? If they're not fleeing war, like in Syria, they're fleeing situations where they no longer can make a living. Like, for example, in Mexico, one of the consequences of the North American Free Trade Association, everybody in the United States says, well, it lost a lot of jobs. But there was another side to it that most people are unaware of, which is part of the free trade agreement allowed American corn, mice, to be sold in Mexico, which it couldn't before. Mexican subsistence farming and also small market farming, their main crop is corn. Once American corn came in, though it came in very cheaply because there were gigantic agribusinesses. All of Illinois, where Chicago is one huge corn farm. They were selling corn in Mexico at prices that the Mexican peasants couldn't meet. So in a sense, the Mexican peasants became dispossessed. Not because somebody went and grabbed their land. They were dispossessed by this free trade agreement. Being dispossessed means they have to try to find another way of living. That is not so easy in Mexico, and it's impossible in Honduras or Guatemala. So they try to go to the United States. Here, I don't know. Syria, if it continues, will empty out. Unless something is done. And the only outside group, power that's doing anything, is of course Russia. And what they're doing is terrible. But they're doing something. People will continue fleeing Syria. And is the answer to let them into Europe? Well, yes, but there's already a huge backlash. Is the answer to keep them in camps in Turkey? That can be a solution. Other than that, it then implicates countries like, or regimes like that in Germany with the Erdogan dictatorship. Not so nice. I wish that I had like a nice policy suggestion. I don't. I really don't. Of course, one has to deal with the kind of racist backlash and see what, and one can deal with it only if one begins to see what kind of fears are being expressed and to try to deal with those fears. To only call people racist isn't enough. That's a very unsatisfactory response, I'm afraid. It's a very unsatisfactory situation. I wish it were otherwise.
Okay, thank you very much for your answers, and I think that it's now time to open the session for the questions from the public, so if anybody has a comment or a question or anything like that, please raise your hand.
Oh, okay.
So we have two hands. Do we have any microphones?
Have not risen since 1973. It's a long time. This was he. For a long time, by the fact that it was fairly easy to buy houses in the United States, and you could use your house almost like a kind of a bank. You could borrow money on your house. That all fell apart in 2008, 2008, 2007, 2008. But one dimension is that the lack of increase in wages was hidden because people lived pretty well on the basis of debt. Now, within a Marxian framework, Marx argues that what he calls value is always dependent on living labor. Overcoming capitalism for him meant overcoming value. If the value base begins to really shrink, then it seems to me that, and this is very abstract still, you have the basis for beginning to generate more and more wealth in the form of debt. Now, debt involves financialization. So I think that the shift, or I'm suggesting, that the shift to financialization goes hand in hand with the crisis of working society, the crisis of labor. And I'm nowhere near trying to tie these two together in a better way. That's my short answer to the first. As far as the second goes, I don't see any problem in terms of criticizing the settlements, criticizing Netanyahu's bad faith. I don't see there's any problem with that. But I do think it's significant to realize that right-wing Israeli movements pay lip service to the idea of a Palestinian state, but don't really mean it. It should, however, also be noted that what I would regard as right-wing Palestinian movements, Hamas, pay lip service, they absolutely don't mean the recognition of Israel. So what you have is two national movements being dominated increasingly by wings that refuse to recognize the other. And those wings play off against one another. One of the best or worst examples was in the mid-90s, as you may or may not know, Rabin was assassinated by a really ideologically driven right-wing Israeli. There were elections. In terms of the polls, it looked like there would be a huge sympathy vote because of Rabin's assassination for the Labour Party and therefore for the continuation of the peace process. What happened during the campaign was a campaign of suicide bombing on the part of Palestinian groups which elected Netanyahu. And they were intended to do so. The people who planned the suicide bombings, as opposed to the suicide bombers, know what they're doing. And what they're doing is political. So in a sense, the right-wing assassin of Rabin and the Palestinian suicide bombers were working hand in glove. And each thinks that if they just drive the other all the way, they will win. It's a terrible situation. You have a boycott movement, which is very ambiguous. If the boycott movement, some people think, is against the boycott of the settlements, is a boycott of the settlements. But if you really pay attention, it's a boycott of the existence of Israel. And then Netanyahu can say, you see, any criticism of the settlements is a criticism of the whole. It's very depressing, but it seems to me the task of political intellectuals is to make distinctions that have been blurred. Does that help?
Yes, thank you, Professor, for this interview, which I enjoyed tremendously. I would, however, like to make a short comment on the first part of the interview, the last question, actually, which is the only question which I can speak intelligently about, the issue of time. Now, you mentioned hours and so on and so forth, and I would just like to make a short comment on it, because I think it deserves some attention, which is that the concept of hours is actually more than 2,000 years old. It was suggested by mathematicians, Hipparchus, actually, a famous mathematician from Nicaea, which is in present-day Turkey. And even the minutes and seconds, they already knew about. And they needed this for the calculations regarding the movements of the sun and the moon. Now, the hours, as the Romans knew, the nighttime hours, the so-called vigils, and the daytime hours, the so-called holiday, they were actually sufficient for getting through the day and through the night. Vigil actually means the two-hour time when a couple of soldiers are leaving their nightstand. And the daytime hours actually do not matter. But the astronomers actually needed very accurate hours. Hence the notion of 24 parts of the day and night together. So the time that you're talking about, I don't know if there's any connection, but the time that you're talking about actually already know the concept of hours from the Hellenistic period, which you may or you probably know.
Thank you, and that is very interesting, but what I find significant is that this, let's call it abstract time, really remained the purview of these specialists. It didn't change timepieces. The water clocks were actually geared, which is very difficult, were geared to variable hours. So that there isn't a general social organization of time on the basis of what I'm calling abstract time. I'm more than willing to concede that Hellenistic scientists, who were pretty remarkable in many respects, did have notions of time as an independent variable, but that did not become socially real until the modern period. And it became real in the modern period, not because someone like Newton developed his notions of time and space, but rather already for two centuries before Newton, in different places, this became an organizing principle of life and made it plausible to think that way, is what I wanted to suggest. But thank you for the historical correction.
Do we have any other questions?
speculation, but I guess with your reinterpretation of Marx's critique, you're giving an answer, for example, to Hannah Arendt's critique of Marx on the issue of labor. And it seems like you're Hannah Arendt's. And it seems like you're actually kind of bringing the two kind of together in a sense on creating a critique of the position labor holds in contemporary societies. And I guess that could be an interesting dialogue, Marx via your interpretation regarding labor, and also thinking about, you mentioned the crisis of work, the trend towards creating superfluous people, be it unemployed or precarious, and this is also something that's really, I think, ingrained in how Hannah Arendt sees position of labor. So I was just thinking, how would you comment on the observation that you're bringing the two thinkers that kind of together, that it wouldn't seem likely?
I'd have to read Arendt in an extremely sympathetic manner, because her critique of Marx is actually a critique of Soviet Marxism disguised as a critique of Marx. And she actually should have known better. I mean, she did know people like Benjamin Adorno. She couldn't stand Adorno, but she should have known better. And I find her discussion of Marx to be singularly unsatisfying. And therefore, she has a critique of labor, which I think you were getting at, but I don't think she has any sense of a possible future beyond that. So it remains kind of static, I think, and then takes a kind of philosophic turn to thinking. And I would maybe have to reread and rethink. But thank you.